Todd Becker says, can you please explain again about polyphenols and hormesis? Again, as a toxin, how this affects glutathione levels. I could not keep up, and I think this may be important. Yeah, so anyone who wants the details on this can go to chrismasterjohnphd.com/antioxidant, where I have a whole course on the antioxidant system. That course, the videos are free. And if you want the premium features like transcripts, keyword searchable videos, and other learning tools, you can sign up with Masterclass with Masterjohn. But for anyone who just wants to know this particular topic in detail, go to the free version at chrismasterjohnphd.com/antioxidant. Scroll down to the episode, just keyword search the page for polyphenols and the lesson will come up. In brief, our detoxification system it didn't evolve to handle the toxins of modern society. Modern society, we invent a new chemical. Our body knows it's a toxin, but it doesn't know it because we were exposed to it for millions of years. It knows it because it has similarity to other toxins. And that similarity may be weaker or stronger, depending on the toxin. Our bodies didn't evolve to be bad at detoxifying. They evolved to be good at detoxifying. And so our system is not designed to get sick when we encounter toxins. It's designed to get healthy when we encounter toxins. So the way that works is, throughout most of our evolutionary history, the toxins we were exposed to were the toxins in plants. Most of them are polyphenols. Most of them are the things that we ascribe health benefits to. A lot of those health benefits come from the fact that these are the toxins that our bodies are designed to work with. So our bodies said, I get daily blasted with milligram amounts of, or 1,000 milligrams, maybe grams in some cases, of these plant toxins. So what am I going to do? Well, I'm going to have an extraordinarily complex system that will, now, getting rid of them is very energy intensive. So I don't want to have this system running in high gear all the time. What I'm going to do is I'm going to estimate my exposure to toxins by the amount of toxins that come into my system. And I'm going to use that as a metric of how much of the extraordinary energy it takes to get rid of toxins should I invest in maintaining a robust expression of the detoxification machinery and the antioxidant protection machinery and the glycation defense machinery. And so these xenobiotic is something foreign. This defense system is this giant umbrella system at a very general level assesses the likelihood of how much energy should we invest in keeping that system running based on how much toxins are we exposed to, and uses that metric to invest the energy in that entire machinery. So we're not investing in getting rid of a specific toxin. We're just taking the collective toxin and investing in the collective detoxification machinery, the collective antioxidant glycation defense machinery. And because fruit and vegetable polyphenols were the major toxins, our system is designed to be very highly responsive to them, to use them as that metric. Now, in modern society, what do? We invented new toxins. These have the same harms. Oh, by the way, the fruit and vegetable polyphenols, what happens if you just take a bunch of them and you dump them on cells? You kill the cells. Right? So what happens when we eat them? 99% of them don't get absorbed. Why? Because the intestinal cells have a detoxification pathway that's just like the liver's. By the way, the liver, never call the liver a filter. And if you do call the liver a filter, you got to call the intestinal cells a filter for certain. They're not a filter. They're pumping out the toxins, right? So the intestinal cell has got the same response as the liver. 99% of the stuff doesn't get absorbed. It goes into your feces. The 1% that gets absorbed gets detoxified by the intestinal cell or makes it to the liver. Whatever makes it to the liver, most of that gets detoxified. You drink a cup of green tea. What do you see in your blood? You don't see epicatechin, epicatechin gallate, epigallocatechin, sorry, no one knows what these terms are. You don't see EC, ECG, EGC, and EGCG. You see the methylated and otherwise detoxified metabolites of those compounds circulating. Why? Because you absorb 1% of it. Whatever made it to your liver got detoxified. What you see is the detoxification metabolites of those. And within 20 hours, they're all gone from your system because your whole goal in life is to get rid of it. Okay, now modern society invents new modern toxins. What do those do? Well, in theory, we do the same thing to them. The difference is we don't have millions of years of exposure to them to optimize our sensors to those. So they become more toxic. Why? Because they come in and have the same toxic potential, but our system is bad at recognizing them. So they cause more toxicity than they cause upregulation of defense. But because we have millions of years of exposure to fruit and vegetable toxins, they cause more defense than they cause toxicity. Because our tuning forks, our sensors are optimized for them. And so let's say you have modern toxins that we invented that you're not very responsive to, and you have fruit and vegetable toxins that you're highly responsive to. What do you want to do? You want to increase the fruit and vegetable toxins so that you can make, so that you can have a better upregulation of the machinery. But because the machinery is generic and is umbrella machinery that detoxifies everything, you can eat the fruit and vegetable toxins to get that response, and you can get use that response to detoxify the modern toxins that we're not as good at detecting. So the principle of hormesis is a little bit of something bad is good for you. That means a little bit of bad things in fruits and vegetables is good for you because it upregulates the detoxification machinery and helps you not just get rid of those that you ate, but it helps you get rid of the, all the other bad stuff. It helps protect your wear and tear of your tissues caused by things that are going on in your body. Like you have diabetes and you make more glycation end products. It helps you defend against that too, because it's general defense. And so you probably do want to eat 5 to 9 servings of fruits and vegetables a day. But do you want to take the EGCG out of the green tea and highly concentrate it into a pill and then take 100 times more EGCG than you could ever get from drinking 2 to 3 cups of green tea and eating, and you know, in the collective with the other fruits and vegetables you're eating? Well, that's where you get into the fact that at some threshold, something that's bad for you is always bad for you, regardless of the principle of hormesis. And so you might have, now take this guy, the person, I forget who it was at the beginning, who asked the question where we said they probably have a defective glutathione synthetase gene. This was Brad. Brad, we decided, had possible defective glutathione synthetase gene. Well, he might be more harmed by like the dose of so there's case reports that EGCG causes liver failure. Usually it's high doses. Maybe there was misformulations in the supplements. There's a lot of questions. People have increased vulnerability. Why might you have increased vulnerability? Well, let's take Brad, who we're thinking maybe has a glutathione synthetase impairment. He upregulates the machinery, but he can't upregulate the glutathione. And so even at the healthy hormetic dose of something, he might be upregulating glutathione synthesis, but he doesn't get the glutathione because he has an impairment in that, in glutathione synthesis. And so now, even the upregulation from the fruits and vegetable polyphenols isn't even enough to deal with the toxicity of the fruit and vegetable polyphenols, because they caused you to engage in a defense that you're not able to engage in. So it's not the case for you that eating those helps you defend against everything else. It's the case for you that you can't even defend against those when you eat them. But that's rare. What's common is that for everyone, there's going to be a threshold where you're just maxing out your defenses and you're crossing the border into just outright toxicity. And so there's going to be a point for everyone at which The fruit and vegetable toxins are just toxic. So that point for the average person is not 5 to 9 a day. We know that because people eating 5 to 9 a day wouldn't have better health outcomes if that were the case. People going on a whole foods plant-based diet would be killing themselves. And, you know, there are some respects in which they might be giving themselves problems, but they're not getting liver failure from eating a lot of fruits and vegetables. So I think where you cross the line is what you don't want to do is isolate those things into a pill and megadose them. And that's why people, when they ask me about sulforaphane and milk thistle, my view of that is that that's what you do when you can't eat a high volume of unrefined plant foods with a 5 to 9 approach to fruits and vegetables. But what you don't want to do is say, well, if the bottle says one capsule of milk thistle a day is good for me, then 10 capsules of milk thistle on top of 10 servings of fruits and vegetables is good for me. Then you're in the zone of who knows what that's doing to you. All right, I hope that helped, Todd.